तेजस्वी नावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
Let us quickly review the solution for the state and output equations that we have obtained in the discrete time domain that was derived in the last class, last lecture. The solution for the state vector xn would be an x0 plus summation on k from 0 to n minus 1, an minus 1 minus k times buk. If an is put in a more compact form, phi n, this is the state transition matrix. Phi n times x0 plus phi n minus 1 convolved with BUN. We saw that in the Z-transform domain, the Z-transform of the state vector would be having this form, Zi minus A inverse Zx0 plus Zi A inverse minus A inverse BUZ. From this, we would see that the state transition matrix phi n and Zi minus A inverse Z form a transform pair. The Z transform of this matrix is equal to this. Similarly, if you have phi n minus 1, state transition matrix, when the value of n is decremented by 1, this will be Zi minus A inverse. A certain point you would note is, suppose we have the poles of Zi minus A inverse are also the zeros of determinant of Zi minus A equal to 0. After all, the determinant of Zi minus A equal to 0 are the same as the zeros of determinant of lambda I minus A equal to 0. Therefore, determinant of Zi minus A is a characteristic equation in terms of Z instead of lambda. So these are also equal to the characteristic values of the system. Characteristic values lambda I. And it turns out these are also the natural frequencies in the discrete time domain. So we may also write this as natural frequencies, natural modes of the discrete time system. So they're all related. Whether you take the characteristic equation of determinant of lambda I minus A equal 0 or determinant of Zi minus A equal to 0, they are the natural modes that we get. Now going back to the output equation, we derive this yn equals c times xn plus d times vn. So c times xn, xn is equal to c times xn will be this expression plus d times vn, which instead of the convolution, if you put it in the summation form, this is the what you would get. And in the transform domain, you get Czi minus A inverse Zx0 coming from this, Czi minus A inverse BUZ coming from this plus DUZ. That is what you have in the transform domain. Of course, this will be called the zero input solution, because when U is zero, this is what results. This is the zero state solution. So zero input solution and zero state solutions are separately shown like this. Now we would also like to keep in mind that this summation extends from k equals 0 up to n minus 1. Therefore, this particular term comes into play from n equals 1 onwards. There is no meaning for this when n equals 0, then because the upper limit is equal to minus 1. You're starting from 0 and proceeding in the positive direction. Therefore, that particular summation or the convolution summation is valid only for n greater than or equal to 1.
it is certainly doesn't apply for n equal 0. Same thing here also. N greater than or equal to 1. Now, suppose the poles of, we saw that the poles of ZI minus A inverse are lambda I. Therefore, coming from this, you take the inverse Z transform of this. Coming from this, you get, assuming that all poles of ZI minus A inverse are simple, you have lambda I over M coming from this. And here, your poles arising not only from ZI minus A inverse, but also UZ. UZ also may have poles. Therefore, you have BI lambda I inverse, summed over L, plus CI. Suppose the poles of UZ, the forcing function are PI, you have PI raised to the power of M. These are poles of UZ. So, in other words, this group of terms, these two groups of terms, will represent the natural response and the lambda I are said to be the natural modes, natural frequencies if you wish, but better call them natural modes, and this is the forced part of the response. This is the forced part of the response. So that is how we identify the two parts in the time domain solution. There's a natural response, that the forced response. Terms coming from the poles of ZI minus A inverse are the natural response terms, and those which are coming from the poles of U of Z are the forced response terms. We can also see immediately that if the initial conditions are zero, this is the total response, and therefore the Laplace transform, the Z transform of the output to the Z transform of the input, which is called the transfer function, is given by CZI minus A inverse B plus D. So H of Z, so transfer function matrix in general, if you have M outputs and K inputs, the transfer function matrix H I J Z is given by C Z I minus A inverse B plus D. That's the transfer function matrix, where H I J N is the impulse response . The inverse Z transform of this will give a matrix in which the ij entry gives the impulse response at the ith output due to an impulse present at the jth input. So if you have a single input, single output system, you have a single H of Z itself, CZI minus A inverse D plus D, which is a scalar. This is whole thing is a scalar. It's not a matrix. And Hn is the inverse Z transform of H of Z, which from this analysis can be shown to be C A n minus 1 times B for n greater than or equal to 1 and D for n equal 0. So taking the inverse Z transform of that, at n equal 0, this is the only term that is present. So the impulse response means YZ will be CZI minus A inverse B plus D times 1, because the Z transform of the impulse is equal to 1. Therefore, the inverse Z transform, D will have value at n equal 0, that value of D. And for values of n larger than 0, it will be the inverse Z transform of this, C A n minus 1 B, that is for n greater than or equal to 1. That then is the summary of the results that we have obtained from the time domain analysis as well as the Z transform analysis of the discrete time systems. And we have seen now how the whole analysis follows exactly on the same lines as for continuous systems, except that we are using now the Z transforms in the Laplace, instead of the Laplace transforms. Let us now work out an example. This is the model of a discrete time system. We would like to analyze it based on the theory that we have developed. So to set up the state and output equations, we consider the state variables
to be those which are at the outputs of delay units. So we'll call that x1n, the signal here x1n, we'll call the signal here x2n. So once we have identified the two state variables, then the state equations can be written x1n plus 1 and x2n plus 1 equals half minus 1 quarter 1 0 x1n and x2n. You can easily see that x2n plus 1 is x1 of n itself, so x2n plus 1 is x1 of n itself. 1, 0, vn. That is the state equation. The output equation yn is obtained as x1n plus this signal, which is x1 of n plus 1. So we have an equation for x1 of n plus 1. To that, we have to add x1 of n. Therefore, it turns out to be 3 by 2 minus 1 quarter x1n x2n plus 1 times un. That is the, these are the state and output equations for the system. Now, we would like to find out the state transition matrix for this. So, lambda I minus A determinant equals 0. It turns out that this will be equal to lambda squared minus lambda by 2 plus 1 quarter equals 0. This is the characteristic equation. So the two characteristic values, lambda 1 and lambda 2, can be shown to be half e to the power of plus or minus j pi upon 3. These are the complex eigenvalues that you get here. So you can expect oscillatory behavior in the response. And An, the state transition matrix for the discrete time system, because this is a second order system, this is a, can be equal to a polynomial of order 1. So C0i plus C1a. So taking the value of matrix A into account, this can be put as C0 plus C1 upon 2 minus 1 quarter C0. And we know that the corresponding scalar equation lambda n equals C0 plus C1 lambda is 2 for lambda equals lambda 1 and lambda 2, these two values that we are getting here. And solving for this, you can show that C0 equals half raised to the power of n cosine n pi upon 3 minus 1 by root 3 sine n pi upon 3. That is C0. And the C1 happens to be 4 upon root 3 half raised to the power of n sine n pi upon 3. These are the values of C0 and C1, and therefore you substitute C0 and C1 into An, you get the state transition matrix An. It turns out to be half raised to the power of n cos n pi upon 3 plus 1 by root 3 sine n pi upon 3 1 by root 3 sine n pi upon 3 minus 1 by root 3 sine n pi upon 3, and here cos n pi by 3 minus 1 by root 3 sine n pi. That then is the state transition matrix. Now suppose I want to find the impulse response. Hn. This is, as we already observed, this is equal to d for n equals 0 and Cam minus 1b for n greater than or equal to 1. So using the value of An, so that means instead of n, you must put An minus 1 substitute over here,
and pre-multiply by C matrix and post-multiply by B matrix. This is the B matrix and this is the C matrix. You carry out the appropriate multiplication and you can show that this is equal to 1 for n equal 0 and half n cos n pi upon 3 plus 5 by root 3 sin n pi upon 3. That then is the impulse response. Transfer function, after all, we have single input, single output system. So, transfer function which is that C is ZI minus A inverse B plus D. And ZI minus A inverse happens to be, I'll write it here because that is required for to calculate this. ZI minus A inverse happens to be Z minus 1 quarter 1 Z minus half, that is a matrix, divided by Z squared minus Z upon 2 plus 1 fourth. So this is ZI minus A inverse. Observe that the poles of ZI minus A inverse, the denominator Z squared minus Z upon 2 plus 1 fourth, is the same as what we had earlier written down as the characteristic equation with the substitution lambda for Z. So this, after simplifying, you get Z squared upon plus Z divided by Z squared minus Z by 2 plus 1 fourth. That then is the transfer function. You can also obtain this transfer function as an alternative by taking the Z transform of this. The Z transform of the impulse response must be the transfer function. So once you know the impulse response, you can take the Z transform of that, you get the same result. But what we have done is we have derived it directly from the formula. Both are equivalent. Now let us proceed further. Suppose you are asked to find out the output corresponding to a specified input in the same problem. So let us say that you are given an input which is a unit step function, that un is an input step function, and you are given initial conditions regarding the x1 and x2. So we have to find out output corresponding to the input un is a unit step function. And the initial values x10 and x20 are given as, let us say, 1 and 0. Then you can calculate the output in two steps, the 0 state solution and the 0 input solution. Y0i of n equals Can x0. And by working out, we have already got the expression for A of n and x0, we know. Therefore, this turns out to be half raised to the power of n, 3 upon 2 cos n pi upon 3 plus 1 by 2 root 3 sin n pi upon 3. That then is the 0 input solution. To get the 0 state solution, we have YOS of n dun plus summation from k equals 0 to n minus 1 of Can minus 1 buk. Now, since the input is a unit step, this is equal to 1. So consequently, we have to see how to get this summation. So Can minus 1 minus k, this should be n minus 1 minus k, because the convolution you have n minus 1 minus k uk. So Can minus 1 minus k b times b from the values that we have got here can be shown to be half of n minus 1 minus k times 3 halves of cos n minus 1 minus k times pi upon 3 plus 1 by 2 root 3 sin n minus 1 minus k by 3 times pi. Now, we would like to sum up such terms. To enable the summation to be effected, it's convenient for us to identify, to write, let e power a be equal to half. If we do that, then we can say cosine of n minus 1 minus k by 3 times pi, this term, times half of n minus 1 minus k, that can be associated, that can be thought of as the real part of e power n minus 1 minus k, n minus, this is the same n minus 1 minus k, times a plus j pi upon 3. Because cosine n minus 1 minus k by 3 times pi is the real part of e power n minus 1 minus k times j pi by 3. And this is, of course, e times a power n, e power a times n minus 1 minus k by this identification. So now, this is an exponential term, and therefore it can be simplified, it can be summed up because this geometric series is obtained. And similarly, we have sine n minus 1 minus k by 3 times pi multiplied by half of n minus 1 minus k can be thought of as the imaginary part of a similar expression. So both these, now the terms can now be summed up, because after all, c power n minus 1 minus k times b is this term here, and therefore the summation can be effected. And finally, you can show that the zero state solution for n is 8 upon 3 plus half raised to the power of n multiplied by 1 by root 3 sine n pi by 3 minus 5 upon 3 cos n pi upon 3. That is the final solution for the zero state output, zero state UI OSN. We already found out the zero input solution, and therefore the final solution YN would be the sum of Y zero input solution plus the zero state solution, where the zero state solution is what we have here, and the zero input solution is what we have obtained. The sum of these is the output. Sum of this is the total solution. Let us now quickly review what we have done under the title state variable methods. We defined the state of the system as the minimum amount of information relating to the past that we need to know to find out the output corresponding to an input prescribed from that point onwards. Now, if you take a non-dynamic system, if we have an input vector and this is the output, y is related to the input directly without any calculus involved. It's a proportionality. The matrix Y is related to the matrix U by D. It is a non-dynamic situation, a resistive network. We don't need to know about initial conditions and so on and so forth. But on the other hand, if you have a dynamic system, you have an intermediate variable X dot equals AX plus BU, where X is the state, and then Y is related to X and U in a non-dynamic fashion. So this can be put in a pictorial way. Suppose you have, this is the input U, you have Y, so you have multiplying by a matrix D, you get one component as the output DU, and then you have X dot and X. This is the state vector, this is the derivative of the state vector, X dot equals AX plus BU.
And then x is related to x dot by integral of the state vector, and the output is related to x by matrix C, Cx plus DU. This is the representation that you get for a dynamic system. In a non-dynamic system, this thing is absent. You have a direct relation between U and Y. And we saw how the state variables can be chosen in both a continuous time system network and a discrete time network. We chose the capacitor voltages and inductor currents as the state variables in the continuous time system, and the outputs or delay units are the state variables in the discrete time system. By no means this is a unique choice. You can have other possible choices, but these are convenient choices. But whatever the choice may be, the number of state variables for a given system will remain the same. If it is by this choice, if it is n, any other choice also, you should have the same number. And the state, we also talked about state transition matrix, which is a very important component of the whole analysis. If you have any state is represented by a point in the n-dimensional space, suppose the dimension of the state variable is n, you can think of an n-dimensional space, and the state is represented by a point, at each state is represented by a point. Suppose this is the initial state x0, and you want to know what is the state at point t, then you multiply by e power at in the continuous time domain. So when you multiply x0 by e to the power of t at different values of t, that provides you the locus of the trajectory that the state will take in n-dimensional space in a continuous time system. In the discrete time system, again, x0 is the initial state. If you want to find out the state at xn, you have to multiply it by a power n. A power n is the state transition matrix in the discrete time situation. So these are concepts which play a vital role in the state space analysis. And we notice that the state variable, the state transition matrix in each case can be expressed as a sum of n square matrices, n where polynomial is obtained by using the Cayley-Hamilton theorem. In each case, if the dimension of the state is n, each of them can be expressed as a sum of n square matrices. Point of view of stability, we can say that suppose you have a linear system, this is the zero point in the stable system, this is the equilibrium point. Suppose you have, you perturb this initial state by giving some energy to the storage elements or whatever it is, and you perturb that, it must return back to this point. Suppose you initially disturb the system from the equilibrium point, it must return to this point, and therefore, as a consequence of that, it turns out that for stability, the requirements of stability are limit as t goes to infinity of e power at must go to 0. Similarly, limit as n goes to infinity of an must go to 0. A consequence of this is that in the continuous time situation, the eigenvalues of a must have negative real parts so that the transient, the natural response decays with time. But in the discrete time case, the eigenvalues of A must have magnitude less than 1. That means so that as n goes to infinity, the natural response goes down to 0. So that is the consequence of this. You recall that when we talked about discrete time transfer functions, we said for stability, the poles must be within the unit circle, and that is a consequence of the fact that the eigenvalues of A must have magnitude less than 1 for stability to be ensured. So in this discussion that we have studied, we have an elementary treatment of state variable techniques is what we have studied. We have studied what is meant by zero state response and the zero input response and how to calculate them. What associated with the state variable theory are concepts of controllability and observability, which are important in modern control theory, but this is outside the purview of this course. The beauty of the state space analysis is that this can be readily extended to nonlinear systems. In a nonlinear system, the form of the equations will be, for a continuous time situation, the f of some function, x of t, u of t, and t. These are the three variables, some complicated function that will be the state equation and the output equation of yt will be some other function of xt, ut, and t. So that means you use this to find out the state, and once you get the state, you substitute here and you get the output. So the general framework will remain the same. Of course, it will not be linear equations. The computer may be necessary to calculate this, but the state variable technique provides you a general framework to study both nonlinear and time-varying systems. In time-varying systems, it turns out that the ABCD matrices are not constants, but for functions of time. So the state variable theory, suffice it to say, plays a very important role in system dynamics, and particularly for computer analysis of the dynamics of systems, because first-order difference equations and first-order differential equations are easy to program in the computer, and they provide a framework for study of general systems. And in control, modern control theory, the state variable techniques play a very important role. And with that, we conclude our discussion of the state variable techniques. Now I will give you a set of examples as forming a part of exercise on the topics that we have studied. The first problem is set up the state equations for the network shown. The state variables are specified in each case. You are given three networks, A, B, C. This is the first network, in which you have two sources. They constitute the input vector E1, E2. And you have two reactive elements. The capacitor voltage VC and the inductor current IL constitute the state vector X. So you set up the state equations. X dot equals AX plus BU. That's all what you are asked to set up. You don't have to worry about the output equation. The values, parameter values of the network are given. So you set up the state equation for this network, identifying this as the state vector and this as the input vector. Then it's B, under the same category, we are given another network. We have one voltage source and one current source. They constitute the input vector U, and the state variables once again are the capacitor voltage and the inductor current. The values of all the elements inside the network are given. So you have to find out the state equation in the standard form for this. These are the state variables VC and IL. The third part, C, again, is a network in which there is only one source here. Therefore, the input is a scalar, U equals ES. But we have three reactive elements. IL1, IL2 are the two inductor currents, and the capacitor voltage VC. These are the state variables, VC, IL1, and IL2. And the other elements are, of course, resistors, 2 ohms and 1 ohm. So once again, for this network also, you have to set up X dot equals AX plus BU, the matrix equation, relating the state variables, the derivatives of the state variables, the state variables themselves, and the input quantity, which happens to be ES. So this is an exercise in forming the state equations. You can adopt the standard technique of replacing the inductors by current sources and capacitors by voltage sources, and draw the equivalent equation, the required equations, in terms of the state variables. The second problem, set up the state and output equations for the network shown. The output desired are V6 and I7. So you are given slightly more complicated network now. You have ES and IS are the input quantities. They constitute the input vector U. And we have VC1, VC2, VC3, IL4, and IL5 are the state variables. There are five reactive elements. They constitute the state variables. And we are asked to find out the output equation taking V6 and I7 as the output quantities. The current in that 1 ohm resistance and the voltage across this 1 ohm resistance are the output quantities. So you have to set up X dot equals AX plus BU, also the output equation Y equals CX plus DU. So this is again a similar exercise as before, but here you are asked to find out the output equation as well. Then going to a discrete time system, third problem, you are given a discrete time network model in which you have two delay elements, therefore this is a second order system, and YN is the output quantity, UN is the input quantity. you are asked to set up the state and output equations for the discrete time system shown in this network. Now, as before, we take the output of the delay element, this signal here and this signal here, as constituting the state vector. And once you have got this as x1n and x2n, x1n plus 1 is the signal here that can be expressed in terms of un, x1n and x2n. So you got the state equation. And the y is the sum of these three signals. This is, of course, x1n multiplied by half. This is x2n multiplied by 1/4. And this signal is x1n plus 1, which you already know. And summing that up, you get an expression for yn. Put this in the standard matrix form for both the state equation and the output equation. Let us go on. Problem number 4, obtain the state transition matrix phi of t and its inverse, phi inverse of t, for the following system matrix of a continuous time system. The A matrix is given by 3 by 3 matrix, that is 2 1 0 0 2 1 0 0 2. The A matrix is also referred to as the system matrix. So this is the system matrix of a continuous time system, and you are asked to find e power at, which is the state transition matrix. Another notation for that is phi of t, and also its inverse, phi inverse of t. Now, if the initial state is 0, 1, 2 transpose, that means instead of writing a column, x1 0 is 0, x2 0 is 1, and x2 0 is 2, instead of that, x3 0 is 2, we have put this in the form of a row and transpose, that means this is actually a column. That is the initial state. Find the 0 input solution of the state vector. That means you have to find out e power at times x0. So you have to find the 0 input solution given the initial state vector and the system matrix here. That is problem number 4. Problem number 5, you are given a network here. The switch S is closed at t equal 0. This is actually closed. After steady state is reached. So the switch was kept open for a long time and it's closed at t equal 0. So switch is S is closed at t equal 0 after steady state is reached in the network shown. Choosing VC and IL as state variables and the current I as the output, A, form the state and output equations. Form these equations, x dot equals ax plus bu and y equals ex plus du. Find the 0 state, 0 input, and total responses. So you have to find out the total response. You should also find out the 0 state part of the response and the 0 input part of the response. So y in this case happens to be this current I. The state variables are the capacitor voltage Vc and the inductor current IL. And the input quantities are these two DC sources, voltage sources, 1 volt and 2 volt respectively. Now this, of course, problem will also involve a second order state matrix, A. So I have to find out e power at state transition matrix. And from the given conditions of the problem, you must find out the initial state vector. That is when the switch is open, final steady state conditions in the circuit will give you an idea of VC0 and IL0. Using that information, you must find out the 0 input solution and 0 state solution using the standard methods. Last problem, sixth problem, obtain the solution of the following state equation. You are given a state equation using A, Laplace transform method, B, time domain approach. So x1 dot x2 dot equals 0, 1, minus 2, minus 3, that is the A matrix, multiplying x1, x2. The B matrix is 0, 1, 0, 1, multiplying ES. EST is a unit step, the input is a unit step function. And the initial state vector is defined by this matrix, x1, 0, x2, 0, 0, 0. That means it is actually a 0 state solution that you are looking for. You find out the solution by two methods. one using the Laplace transform approach, then secondly using the time domain approach, and compare the two solutions and verify that they lead to the same final solution. That is problem number 6. Question number 7. Find the transfer function of the continuous time system described in the following equations. X1 dot X2 dot matrix equals minus 5, minus 1, 1, minus 2, that is the A matrix multiplying X1, X2, plus 2, 5 multiplying U, the B matrix is a column with entries 2, 5. The output equation Y is 1, 2 multiplying X1, X2. The C matrix, therefore, is a row with entries 1 and 2. The D matrix is absent. So this is a second order system. It's a continuous time system. And you have a single input and a single output. Therefore, you find the transfer function, which is a scalar, HFS, of the continuous time system, which is described by the following equations in a state space description. This is the A matrix, the B matrix, the C matrix, D of course is 0. So you have to use the straightforward formula, C times SI minus A inverse times B, and then get the solution for the transfer function. The last problem concerns a discrete time system. A discrete time system is governed by the following matrices with their usual notation, in the usual notation. The A matrix is 0, 1 minus 0.02 and plus 0.3, that is the A matrix. B matrix is a column with entries 0 and 1. C matrix is a row matrix with entries 1 and 0. D is a scalar 1. Find the state transition matrix phi of n. Now, you notice that this is a second order system. The state vector has a dimension 2. And since BU is the second term and B has only one column, that means the input is also a single input. That we are talking about a single input, single output system. Find the impulse response of the system, HFM. If it is a multiple input, multiple output, such situations you get impulse response matrix. But now we are talking about a single impulse response because it's a single input, single output system. Part C, given that X1 0, X2 0 is 1 0, that is the initial state, and that the input is a unit step, so the input function un equals 1 for all values of n greater than or equal to 0. Determine the response of the system for n greater than or equal to 0 and identify the 0 input and the 0 state components in it. In it means in the response. So you have to find out the 0 input response of the system, 0 state response of the system, add them up, you get the total response. Or if you straight away found the total response, find the in two components separately. You can work this out either in the transform domain or in the time domain. It is suggested that you work out in both ways and then compare the solutions, verify that they agree. The last part is find the discrete time transfer function H of Z of this particular system. This is a single input, single output system as already mentioned. Therefore, the transfer function is a scalar. In general, H of Z would be a transfer function matrix in a general situation with multiple inputs and multiple outputs. In this case, it's a single input, single output system. You are asked to find out the transfer function H of Z of the discrete time system. And now, a final word to all those who have stayed with me so far. The material covered under this course, entitled Networks and Systems, is a very important and useful part of the undergraduate curriculum in electrical engineering for students specializing either in electrical power or communication engineering. The input-output relations of a system in various descriptions, the representation of signals by different means, the concept of spectrum and harmonic analysis, the idea of impulse response, the frequency response of a system, transfer function, or system function as it is otherwise called, network functions of various kinds, the principle of superposition and convolution, the idea of state, the notion of a state, and its relation to the input and output. These are all important concepts and will have a significant presence in the further courses that you may take up. So this course will provide you with the necessary background to take additional courses in subjects like electronic circuits, communication theory, control theory, signal processing in the analog or digital domain, topics covering aspects of dynamic behavior of power apparatus and systems, instrumentation, and the like. In all these courses, the concepts and techniques that we have discussed in this present course will be found useful. We have limited our discussion, and the main thrust of our course is linear, time-invariant, dynamic causal systems. Threading through all the topics that we have covered here are two important principles, the superposition principle and the concept of convolution. These are important concepts, and we have used them in time and again in our work. When we are discussing the principles of analysis of linear time invariant systems and the techniques for such analysis, we have discussed them under the framework of electrical networks. There are two reasons for this. One, you will be called upon, the analysis of networks is important in its own right, because you will be called upon to analyze various kinds of electrical and electronic networks in your further courses, either because these circuits have been designed and constructed with a specific objective in mind using RLC elements, op amps, transistors, and the like, control sources, that is, or because such circuits or networks are equivalent representations or equivalent circuits of various electrical apparatus, devices, and systems, like the equivalent circuit of a transistor, equivalent circuit of a transformer, whatever it is. A second occasion for you to use the principles of network analysis would be when you are asked to design networks to perform certain functions, like filter design, design of compensating, equalizing networks, and so on. These design and synthesis tasks require, as a prerequisite, a good grasp of the analysis methods, and therefore the study of network analysis methods that we have taken up here would be quite important in all these situations. A second reason for our studying general system concepts through the framework of networks is because when you study these general techniques through the familiar and concrete example of electrical networks, it will quicken your understanding of the concepts, and you will have a firmer grip on these techniques, so that when you want to extend this, when you have occasion to extend this to other kinds of systems, say electromechanical systems, you will have a greater facility to do this when you want to apply these techniques to general systems in a wider context. We have discussed continuous time systems and discrete time systems, but you would have noticed that there is a lot of commonality between these two, even though the details are different. The philosophy of the various techniques, the approaches are quite parallel. We talk about impulse response, transfer function, and so on and so forth, almost in the same way. Details, of course, are different. In one case, we talk about differential equations. In the other case, we have difference equations. In one case, we speak of functions which are valued every instant of time. In the other case, we have functions which have values only at discrete instants of time. There are differences, of course, but the philosophy of the approach towards solutions are essentially the same, as you would have noticed. Differences, of course, arise because one is a discrete time situation, the other is a continuous system. Among the important differences that you have noticed is, instead of convolution integral, you have convolution summation. In the case of discrete time situation, you have the frequency response is a periodic function of the frequency, which is not the case in the continuous, which is not necessarily the case in the continuous time case. So we find a certain unity in the analysis methods, whether you apply them to the continuous time case or discrete time case. The study of the linear time invariant system that we have taken up in this course will be useful to you later on when you take up study of more advanced systems which are neither linear nor time invariant, that is when you take up nonlinear or time variable systems. Lastly, as a fallout of this course, you would have gained an appreciation of the role of mathematics in the solution of physical problems. So the principles of linear algebra, differential equations, and complex variable theory, you would have noticed, come in very handy in the solution of engineering problems of the type that we have taken up. You would also have noticed that to solve a particular physical problem, there are various approaches available. You can look at it from different viewpoints and then take up different approaches to the solution. Now, a mastery of different techniques, trying to get a mastery of different techniques, is not really a wasteful exercise, because if you have studied different techniques, that will give you a clarity of the behavior of the system and a multidimensional sort of depth or insight into the problem. And of course, you can choose the most appropriate effective method in a given context, in a given context. This is a feature of the various approaches, various methods we have studied under the category of networks and systems. And this is a principle which we will find useful in your further work. Good luck and Godspeed to you.